So I put together in a lecture like this, I'm never quite sure how much to go in the background. You guys are all engineering based, so you can grasp a lot of the concepts. Some of the areas, though, get very nuanced. And I tried to pick out some of the key ones that you probably haven't seen before unless you've been exposed to lighting or LEDs and try to go into those in a little bit more detail. And the other kind of basic physics stuff I skipped over kind of briefly. But if you have questions, please stop during my lecture and we can go into anything you want to drill into today. Lighting is kind of an interesting technology to merge with high tech. Unlike internet and Wi-Fi, that's all brand new, mobile devices, which were all brand new, lighting has been with us for throughout the evolution of mankind. So we have very visceral response to lighting. For example, the lighting in this room is really bad and could be improved. We have a natural predilection towards daylight, and bright, high scotopic content during the day, and at night we feel most comfortable under what are called warm white light settings, especially light coming from below. And these are things you cannot easily change. This is stuff that's built into our DNA, so to speak. And it gets interesting because when you start to develop the technology piece, you find that at the end of the day there's an end consumer who really doesn't care anything about the technology. So it's very different than some of the other high-tech sectors where you have to instead have a new language to talk about quality of light, the importance of what can be done with LED technology in terms of dynamic control of lighting or making the luminaire disappear, so to speak. So a lot of interesting aspects of design and health and well-being in this sort of aspect. So everybody's an expert in lighting, and that's what we learn right away when we start to develop a new business on it and try to disrupt or supplant what people have gotten used to over the last 100 years, like the Edison bulb, which is being phased out, as you probably know. So lighting's fairly fundamental. It consumes 20% of worldwide electricity, believe it or not. In some cases, in industrial buildings, it's more like 30% of the electricity in an industrial building is going to lighting. So it's not a small component of energy consumption. It's also a very large market. And so you have a lot of companies interested in either maintaining their market share of lighting, the conventional old companies like GE, Philips, and Osram, and then you have some of the new upstarts, the bigger consumer electronics companies trying to figure out how they can get into this market. So it's a pretty interesting and dynamic place. I broke my video into three sections, so I'll talk about LED fundamentals in the beginning, and then I'll transition into lighting-specific concerns to talk a little bit more about lighting applications and how we need to think about LEDs to deploy towards lighting. And then thirdly, I'll talk about SORAA's strategy, in particular what we're doing over here in Fremont. So LED fundamentals, I can probably go through this pretty quickly. I assume that most of you guys dealt with this in your undergraduate semiconductor course. But basically we have a semiconductor, a single crystal lattice of atoms that specify a photonic, that specify electronic band gap. And we can dope the materials, either N-type or P-type, to provide charge carriers that can, under applied bias, recombine in the active region of the material near the P-N junction. And under the right conditions, electron hole can recombine and give off a photon that's equivalent to the band gap at that position. So the neat thing about LEDs, which is very different than other conventional lighting sources, is that it's fundamentally non-destructive and theoretically 100% efficiency. It's not quite true today, but some of the numbers that I'll talk about might shock you in how good the LEDs are getting at this point. So a very, very different situation than the evaporating tungsten filament or a mercury discharge that's exciting phosphors. And I'll talk about that a little bit in detail in a minute. The other aspect we need to consider is that for, unlike a telecom application where we're just worried about watts, we have to worry about what our eye sees, because in a lighting application, what matters is what our eye sees. And so we have to deal with luminosity, and that's the eye response, which has a shape like this. So it's peaked in the green. We're most efficient at seeing yellow-green light at about 555 nanometers. Luminosity function, which was defined by the CIE earlier last century, defines 1 watt of optical power at 555 nanometers at 683 lumens. And the rest of the curve has a shape like this. And you see there's very little lumens in the blue and a fall off of lumens in the red. And so obviously light sources that are very peaked in the green are going to be very efficacious. We're going to see them very well. But nevertheless, in order to render colors properly, you need to have the right amount of blue and red. And so you can't, there's this trade-off, it's a fundamental trade-off between light quality and color rendering characteristics and the efficacy of the light source, how easily we're able to illuminate a room with it or any setting with it. And so knowing that, this hasn't been lost in the lighting community for the last century. This slide kind of summarizes in a situation, the situation with incandescence, fluorescence, and LEDs. So we have here the wavelength on a logarithmic scale and the spectral irradiance of various sources. For an incandescent tungsten radiator, for example, is very much like a black body. It puts the vast amount of its energy in the infrared where I cannot see it. It's basically a heater. Again, this is a log scale, so it's a little bit misleading, but if you look outside this visible spectrum, which is bracketed by the dashed lines here, 95% of the incandescent power is going into this region out here. And so really, these lamps are heaters. And in fact, I understand there's a company in Germany that in order to get around some of the European bans on incandescent bulbs is selling 100-watt incandescents as heaters. And is somehow able to get out from underneath these issues with banning the technology. So there's interesting loopholes people can play. But yeah, they're 95% heat. Only 5% of the power is going to light. And that's why they're really bad light sources from an energy conservation point of view. The development of fluorescent technology was largely motivated to try to get around this problem, to put all of the energy of the light source where our eyes can see it. And so this gray curve here shows line-emitting phosphors, which are fairly popular in fluorescent bulbs, and these are excited by a mercury discharge. And the mercury emission is very efficient, about 80% efficient from the electrodes going in to ignite the mercury line at 254 nanometers. But here we have 5-volt photons that we have to convert to the visible, which is an average of about 2.5-volt photons. So there's a fundamental 50% penalty and efficiency built into the fluorescent technology. So we're not expecting to see fluorescent bulbs near, you know, a 100% theoretical limit based on, at least not based on mercury transition. There are some other lighting technologies I won't go into detail, but if you have questions about them, we can talk about it later. But these are the mainstay three for, especially for residential and for the bulk of commercial lighting as well. With LEDs, we have the opportunity to put all the light exactly where we need it. The most common approach, and I'll mention more details about this, is to take a blue or violet emitter and pump phosphors that are nearby in energy, so the Stokes loss is very low. Another opportunity would be to take, you know, individual LEDs at different colors and combine them together and make white light. But the interesting thing is that, of course, you know, again, on paper, the LEDs are the ultimate lamp. Nick Lognac, who invented the red LED in 1962, in fact, we just celebrated the 50th year anniversary of the LED at Illinois a couple of weeks ago, described this in a paper back in 2000 about how the LEDs could be the ultimate lamp, and theoretical efficiencies near 100% are at least, again, possible on paper. Another interesting thing about LEDs is that in the case of special artifacts like art, Mona Lisa and the Louvre, when you have to illuminate these things for people to enjoy them. And guess what? They don't like IR, they don't like heat, and they certainly don't like UV, because the articles can be destroyed over time by having photon energy that's too high or conditions that are too dry or too much irradiated power that's not useful for light. So the LED or the Mona Lisa has been lit by LEDs, I think, for the last already 12 years before the technology was really ready for it, because they were so concerned about preserving these artifacts. And so it's a very powerful situation to be where we can control the spectrum exactly as we want, deliver light only where our eye sees it and not anywhere else. No heat, no harmful ultraviolet radiation. There are basically two material systems that drive LED technology today. There's a lot of research in other materials. There's research into organic LEDs, which I won't talk about, that are pretty far behind inorganic LED-based technology. But these are the two mainstay material systems. They're both compound 3-5 semiconductor systems. The earlier system developed was a 3-phosphide system on gallium arsenide. So gallium arsenide substrates have been around for quite a while, driven by telecom applications and RF applications. And turns out, sure enough, that you can provide the right stoichiometry of aluminum, gallium, indium phosphide and maintain a lattice match to the cubic gallium arsenide lattice and grow, you know, defect-free materials. And with the gallium and aluminum substitution, you can change the band gap of the material. So you can move anywhere from, you know, aluminum, indium phosphide to indium, gallium phosphide, from the red towards the yellow, and provide LEDs in that wavelength regime around 2 electron volts, give or take. one thing you see right away is that the band gap engineering potential is fairly small. You quickly hit a rail with indium aluminum phosphide at a fairly low voltage of 2.1 or so volts. And if you have an emitter that's 1.9 to 2 volts, you only have about 100 millivolts of band gap engineering for carrier confinement and designing the device to operate efficiently. And that's a problem. So there are issues with Allen gap, like temperature, high temperature performance and stuff that are not so great. But nevertheless, the best red LEDs today are based on this material system, and even into the red-orange. All the LEDs you see in the backs of cars or in red traffic signals are based on this material system. The other material system, and really the workhorse for lighting, is the gallium nitride or indium gallium nitride material system. It's a little bit different situation. So there is no native substrate, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. It's been kind of a big deal. Unlike gallium arsenide and silicon that can be grown from the melt, gallium nitride cannot be grown from the melt, and it's proved to be a challenge for the industry. So the industry actually ended up evolving by figuring out ways to put down gallium nitride on form materials like sapphire. And there were some very key events in the late 1980s in Japan, figuring out how to put down single phase gallium nitride material on sapphire, figuring out how to make that material P-type by magnesium doping. And with those building blocks, the first wave of LED technology on gallium nitride was developed. And that's more or less what we enjoy today, is the fruits of that work. but there's clearly some differences. So in order to get into the visible spectrum, in the violet, blue, green, we have to basically move to indium gallium nitride. We need to reduce the band gap energy. And as we do that, we walk off the gallium nitride line. So the gallium nitride is deposited on sapphire. Now you have a gallium nitride lattice constant. When you start to introduce indium nitride into the lattice, you have a bigger atom that doesn't fit, and so you build up compressive strain. The other thing that's interesting about InGaN is that this material is a wurtzite material, so it's not symmetric. And so as you grow the materials, typically you're growing on the basal plane, so you have an elongated hexagonal lattice, and you, as you grow layers, with different material properties, you have spontaneous and piezoelectric polarization fields that build up in the structure, so the band gap is distorted with built-in fields that are pushing carriers around in ways that are complicated and make understanding the device physics of a GaN device fairly can be confusing, and also result in performance limitations. But nevertheless, gallium nitride-based devices with indium gallium nitride active emitters emit all the way from 365 nanometers up to 550 or so nanometers, and you can get all of those emitters in those wavelength regimes. There's also a lot of work on deep UV. I won't talk about that, but either based on gallium nitride or even more likely aluminum nitride spanning this regime. And there's interesting applications like water purification, disinfection at very short wavelengths, like 276 nanometers or so, that are also available with this material system. As I mentioned before, one could make white by mixing red, green, blue, yellow LEDs, for example. And of course, you could, if they were on different track drivers, you could have a spectrum that's changing with time or with music or during the time of the day, however you want to do it. And there's certainly products out there that make use of this. In terms of just producing a high-quality static white, it is fairly complicated to do that. If you need more than one driver and an application that's cost-sensitive is lighting, because people don't like to pay money for lighting if they don't have to, it can be difficult to have an inexpensive solution based on multi-primary. Much more common, commonly done to produce white light is using down conversion material. So what we mean by down conversion is take a blue or violet photon of 3 volts or so to 183 volts and down convert that to the visible using phosphors. And so a typical, this is from a paper by Phillips a few years ago when I was there, just shows a cartoon of what we have. We have an LED chip on a package, and in this case it's a blue emitter, and it's surrounded by particles of two phosphors, a red phosphor and a green phosphor, and by mixing the primary blue light and the secondary emission from the red and green phosphors, we can have white light. And with the right choice of materials, you can build up a wide range of spectra there. And then the beautiful thing about this device is very simple. You have one LED, one driver. The down conversion has happened, you know, happens built in the assembly of the device. And with the right kind of materials, you can provide interesting spectra that are useful for lighting applications. And so by far, 90%+ of white LEDs today are using this approach. So LED luminous efficacy now, this is lumens per electrical watt, has increased exponentially over the last several decades. So again, 50 years ago, the first emitter was demonstrated by Nick and G Research Labs in 1962 as 0.2 lumens per watt or so. It was extremely inefficient. But the material systems continue to be developed. Eventually, the gallium arsenide substrates were removed to provide for fully transparent aluminum gallium phosphide emitters, and so you had red emitters now, red orange emitters approaching 100 lumen per watt in performance. You had the InGaN materials, which came on really in the 90s with their performance coming up rapidly behind the red emitters, and around last decade you have several emitters now crossing the 100 lumen per watt barrier. As a reference point, you know, incandescent bulb that we're all familiar with, 60 watt bulb is about 15 lumens per watt. Again, this is this 95% heater. Tungsten halogen is a little bit better because the filaments run a little bit hotter, a little bit brighter, and you see more of the efficiency there, but it's not much more. It's on the order of 20 lumens per watt at the source level. Fluorescence, good fluorescence can approach about 100 lumens per watt. A more typical number for a compact fluorescent you get in a store is something like 50. There's also high-intensity discharge lamps, which are getting traction, especially in retail sectors. They're pretty efficient sources, more than 100 lumens per watt, and they put out a ton of light. But they use fairly complicated electronic ballasts to be able to ignite the discharge, and they have interesting burn characteristics. The color can change over time. The light output is kind of non-uniform over time. And they tend to be large. So in small applications, they don't work nearly as well. The U.S. Department of Energy has a roadmap on taking LEDs out to 200 to 250 lumens per watt or so before they asymptotically roll over. And as a reference point, a theoretical limit for any reasonable spectrum based on color rendering that we would all consider reasonable for illumination is about 400 lumens per watt. So you're not going to see a source better than that that's truly white. I think that's it for that slide. So, you know, I haven't really gone much into the lighting stuff yet. I'll go into that in the next section. But, you know, even before the end of the last decade, you see LEDs penetrating massively into all of these applications. So cell phone market, displays, LCD TVs, jumbotrons like the AT&T Bell Park, the backs of automobiles, also, you know, cell phone flash for camera phones were a driver, believe it or not, for LED technology. The market was, at the end of last year, about $12.5 billion, again, with the vast majority of the applications not being illumination, but being all these other things, LCD backlighting being a very, very large one. The compact fluorescent, the cold cathode fluorescent tubes really started to fall away to LEDs around the middle of the last decade because the LEDs had basically were getting better and better in terms of efficiency, cost was going down, and it allowed very thin form factors. So you see all these advertisements for really thin LCD TVs. That's possible. It's made possible by LEDs. The fluorescent technology could not.